President William Jefferson Clinton. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Whoa. Thank you. I want to thank all the officials and candidates who are here. Mayor Murphy, thank you. Representative Peterson, Attorney General candidate, Don Quick. I told him once that being Attorney General was the best job I ever had. Because unlike being governor or president, you didn't have to appoint or disappoint. You didn't have to hire or fire many people. And if you did anything really unpopular, you could blame it on the state constitution. I want to thank Senator Michael Bennett, for whom I was honored to campaign. Representative Ed Perlmutter, thank you for what you said. And I'm glad to be here for John Hickenlooper and Mark Udall. Now, I feel kind of out of place in this election season because I'm not mad at anybody. I mean, I just lived to go to my 50th high school reunion, which was a hoot. And I just became a grandfather. And my daughter told Hillary and me that she really wanted us involved in our first grandchild's life, and we were seeing her four or five times a week until I left to go on this trek. So every morning, Chelsea, or my son-in-law, Mark, sends me a picture so I can see what's happening to my grandchild. And, you know, kids, they have no vision for about 3 weeks. They can hardly see anything. Then it starts to grow to normal over a three-month period. And so today I got my first picture of my four-and-a-half-week-old grandchild staring at this humongous toy right above her eyeline in the bed. And here's the relevance of this. The purpose of politics is to empower people to make the most of their own lives, to give them a chance, no matter what their station in life, to grow and flourish. And we are fighting elections where everybody's mad at Washington, everybody's frustrated with what's going on. They say they don't like this extreme partisanship, and yet because of the Supreme Court putting a for sale sign on America with the Citizens United case, we are being bombarded with all these negative ads designed to stop us from thinking. And we were laughing at my 50th high school reunion about how long we had been consumers ever since we started watching television as kids, you know, and you watch the ads and people are trying to sell you something. It's been my experience that when people try to sell me something with a strategy to stop me from thinking, they do not have my best interest at heart. Right? And on the other hand, if people talk to you like you've got half good sense and let you ask them questions, even if you disagree with them, you may want to go along. Now, I've always thought of Colorado, where I've been coming here now for 34 years. And I had, since I left the White House, except for when I came for Michael Bennett in his race, by and large, I've come here for totally non-political purposes. I used to gather all my donors, who included Democrats, Republicans, and Independents every year, to talk about what our foundation was doing. And earlier this year, we had our global initiative just for the American economy in Denver, and it went really well. Here's what I know, two things. First of all, wherever in the world people are working together across the lines that divide them, good things are happening. Secondly, wherever people are building walls and trying to keep people all torn up and upset all the time, good things are not happening. So this morning I started with, I just want to show you this, because believe it or not, that's what this election's about. When we had the Clinton Global Initiative in New York in September, our very first commitment was with a group of our partners who sent 150,000 pounds of medical equipment to the Ebola-affected countries. They have now sent, no government involvement, all cooperation, they have now sent 450,000 pounds with 200,000 to go. Now, why am I telling you this? Because when Americans are our best, that's what we do. Ebola was, you know, we had one person in America with Ebola, and all of a sudden, you know, it was, see how quick we can blame the president for this. We've nailed him with everything else. We can just do this. Grown-up countries, people interested in the future, join hands, work together, debate, argue, and then figure out how to get the show on the road. That's what Washington needs. Now, here's the second thing I want to say. America is coming back. We had this terrible financial crash in late 2008. And in the last 150 years, it's taken countries, rich countries, an average of 10 years to get over these financial crashes. 1872, 1892, 1932 in the Depression in America, 2008. In Japan, they had a crash in 1990, and when I left office 10 years later, they weren't out of it. Now, America got back all the jobs it lost last month. It took us 6 years to do what it's taken 10 years to do. Now, there are, and we did it dealing with a lot of national security challenges and other things, with a Democratic president who's had not one but two Republican defense secretaries, a Republican secretary of the Army, Republican secretary of transportation, and tried to, you know, get us all together. We're coming back. So the question, the reason Colorado is so important this year to all the rest of us is that everybody looks at you as the state of the future. You have diversity, you have youth, you have energy resources, you have great universities, you've got a great technology base. There's nothing you can't do. The question is, what are the terms on which we're going to come back? The real issue in this election, policy-wise, is whether we're going back to trickle-down economics or we're going to invest in our people, grow the economy. Don't let anybody kid you. That's what's paying for all these negative ads coming in from out of state. It's whether we're going back to trickle-down economics. That's what's paying for all this information to convince half the seniors in this country that the Democrats have cut Medicare when we've got more insurers wanting to participate in the Medicare Advantage program than ever before, and not a single senior citizen in the entire country has had Medicare cut. It's a big myth. And so what's paying for it is the fond hope that Americans can be so churned up and so anxiety-ridden that you will forget yourselves and vote to go back to trickle-down economics. Now, here's what I want to say. The only reference I want to make to the past. Since the 70s, there has only been one period when we all grew together. The 8 years when I was president. You've had, wait a minute. You had five terms of trickle-down economics, where we cut taxes on the wealthiest Americans, spent more money. Under the first 12 years, we increased the debt of the country 4.5 times. Second time we tried it, we doubled the debt again, and then left the mess for the president and the current government to try to clean up. We did the best when President Reagan was in office because we had never done that before. We'd never gone on a sugar high before where we cut taxes and increased spending and blew up the debt, and it was like a one long stimulus program. But look what happened. The top 20% of the economy when President Reagan was in office did a little better than they did under me. It's actually all the top 2%. Their incomes went up about 22% and only 20.5% when I was president. The next 20%, 25% better in the 1990s when I was president. The middle of the country did 50% better when I was president. Wait, wait. The fourth 20% did twice as well when I was in office. And here's the kicker of all. The bottom 20%, the people that are working hard trying to get into the middle class, their incomes increased in the 8 years of President Reagan, 0.7%. In our 8 years, 23.6%. So what happened? We grew together. So there are two lessons to this. Inclusive economics works better than trickle-down economics. And inclusive governance, which includes non-governmental groups and ordinary citizens, works better than my way or the highway. Now, so fast forward to the present day. You got a governor's race and a Senate race. And I wrote this down. You'll have to forgive me for using this. My glasses. But look, everybody in Colorado can vote. It's the easiest place in the country to vote. So it's just a question of who votes and who wants it bad enough. But what does a governor do? I did that job for 12 years. You have to worry about economics, education, the environment, handling disasters, and making sure everybody feels like they're a part of what's going on. That's basically what governors do. Now, when Governor Hickenlooper took office, you were 40th in the country in job growth, and now you're fourth. When he took office, you had a 9.1% unemployment rate. Now it's 3.7 in this county. When he took office, you had a deficit. Now you got a surplus. You've had 13 natural disasters, including that horrible flood last year, when all the roads were fixed ahead of schedule. And why is this a race? I mean, really. You got the highest air quality standards in the country now, including the most significant challenge that natural gas drilling presents, methane emissions. You finally have regulations there, which every state in the country ought to follow. You can bring this gas up, but you got to keep the methane from leaking. Education has been fully funded, and one of the things that the Hickenlooper administration has done that means a lot to me personally, because of all the military veterans that we have in my native state of Arkansas and my adopted state of New York, and because Hillary was on the Armed Services Committee, is he has made it possible for military families to be certified to do work based on their experiences in the military, so they don't have to spend the money and the time to go back to school to learn how to do what they already know how to do. That means a lot. Now, his opponent, I remember when he won, they said, the Republicans are breathing a high sigh of relief. The moderate has won. This is supposed to be a libertarian state where you want the people to make as many of their own decisions as possible. He came out for repealing the 17th Amendment so you couldn't elect your own senators anymore, and said that the president's Hawaii birth certificate was a myth. So I thought, those guys have got a very low threshold for what constitutes a moderate. And what's been the strategy against Hickenlooper? Let's find one or two things he did that we can get a majority of the people to question and just advertise it till the cows come home. I want to tell you something. I did that job for 12 years. You make thousands and thousands and thousands of decisions. You cannot make them all right. Nobody is that good. You got to look at the record. It'd be hard to find a more sort of apolitical politician than John Hickenlooper, right? I mean, he came here as a geologist. He wound up starting a microbrewery. He had the audacity to run for office with nothing but positive ads. He actually trusted you to figure out who was your best problem solver, who was your best progress maker, who could create the best future. He's what you say you want. You need to tell your neighbors they got to vote for him every single day between now and Election Day. Now, let's look at the Senate race. To me, this is even more unbelievable. If you took a picture of Mark Udall wearing what he's wearing today with that big smile on his face, it would look like an ad for Colorado. Every positive stereotype you have is embodied in this one person. And what does a senator do? He's supposed to help the state and faithfully represent the country, too. So you got all these people saying, well, you got to vote against all the Democrats because of ISIS. That's what they're saying. Feel very insecure. You see, it's all over America. Feel very unsettled. Now, look, we didn't have anything to do with ISIS starting in Syria. The Syrians were allied with Iran. They didn't ask us for advice. ISIS spread to Iraq because they wouldn't take our advice and have an inclusive government, which included the Shiites and the Sunnis, so they created a big gaping hole in the country for the best bank robbers in history to move into. And I am not minimizing their threat, but Mark Udall has served with real distinction on the Senate Armed Services Committee. If you really want us to develop the most intelligent possible response to this, you would vote for Mark Udall, not for somebody who's just criticizing what's in the headlines today. And Colorado is a place where you say you want to develop your natural resources, but you want to protect the environment. You want to do it in a way that helps the fight against climate change, not undermines it. Governor Hickenlooper got the environmentalists and the natural gas producers together, and his opponents are attacking him for doing what you say you want. And here's Mark Udall on the Energy Committee, the one committee where he has a reasonable chance to give you what you say you want. Protection of the environment, development of your resources. And somehow you're supposed to replace him. Then, I got one other thing I want to mention. He's taken good care of Colorado. He's used his Senate seat to do legitimately important things. Increasing the services at a veterans hospital in Grand Junction. Getting the Forest Service modern air tankers so you can put those fires out quicker. Big deal. Working with your Republican, then Republican senator to keep Rocky Flats open and make it secure for all time. And fighting through the Republican-engineered government shutdown, which his opponents supported, to keep the recovery from the flood open, keep it going. Now, we all say we want Democrats to work with Republicans and Republicans to work with Democrats. Listen to this. There is not one other senator in the entire Senate who can best this record. Udall worked with a Republican senator to legislate the line item veto, worked with another Republican senator to successfully end earmarks to protect your tax dollars, worked with a whole bunch of Republican senators to authorize what became the bipartisan Simpson-Bowles Commission that said, here's how you should deal with the debt long term, but don't do it now or you'll throw us back into recession. Worked with another Republican to get some money in the farm bill for rural development for all these small towns in Colorado that are being left out and left behind without investment. And to develop the bipartisan immigration reform bill, which his opponent opposes. So, what are they saying running against him? Well, his opponent's strategy seems to me to be to first use that out-of-state Koch brothers money wherever it's possible to put the president on the ballot instead of Udall. Second, to repeal health care. Let me just give you a little primer on this. First of all the bad publicity on health care dealt with policies in the individual market. That's 10% of us only. The initial rollout of the website was a mess, but it got fixed. That's what you're supposed to do when you make a mistake, is fix it. And because you're participating, and lower-income working families got the Medicaid expansion, and other people got to buy rates off the exchange, it has just been announced that next year, in the Denver area, health care premiums, which were going up at 16% a year before the bill passed, will go up at 0.7% next year. And that the price of the most used plan, the so-called silver plan, will actually go down $75 a year. Now, when we started this, you were spending almost 18% of national income on health care, more than $1 trillion more than anybody else is spending. It's already down to 17.2%. Our coverage is better. Our health care is better. We're paying for performance instead of individual procedures more and more and more. You want to repeal that?
No.
Now, does it need some work? Yeah, it needs some work. We still got to work out some things involving small business coverage and even for some of the larger employees, and whether the standards are a little too detailed. There's all this stuff. But to do that, you want somebody with a record like Mark Udall of working with Republicans and Democrats to solve real problems, not somebody who says, let's throw out the baby with the bathwater. That would be a terrible mistake. And now, the one thing where they got a clear difference here is on whether we're going to have shared prosperity and shared responsibilities, whether we're all going to be part of one community. Senator Udall is for the minimum wage. He is for equal pay for equal work. He thinks we should reform the student loan program so these kids can refinance their loans at market interest rates or below, and they could pay off at a share as a percentage of their income. All over America, there are hundreds of thousands of people in every state who actually spent some time in the state going to college and had to drop out because they didn't have the money to finish, or they were terrified that they could never pay their debts. He wants to fix that. The other guys, you know what their plan is? Double the interest rates on student loans and don't increase the Pell Grants. This is not complicated. If you want a progressive future we can all share in the economy, you better vote for Mark Udall. That's what this is about. Then, I can't believe that. Then there's this argument that I thought I'd die when I read this. It's Senator Udall. Senator Udall had overemphasized the social issues. He didn't ever say he was for a constitutional amendment, a personhood amendment, to basically take away a woman's right to choose. So his opponent, who is an attractive guy, says, well, I'm not for that anymore. Everything's all right. And I'm okay on letting women buy contraceptives. Hello, that's been legal for several decades now. Like I said, there's a pretty low standard for what counts as moderate in a Republican Party. But what they don't tell you is this. He's still on the bill in Washington, D.C. to do the same thing as the amendment. Members of Congress every day take their names off bills they no longer support. It is a routine thing. There's a reason that name hadn't been taken off that bill. Second, it sounds so good, okay with me, if women buy contraceptives. See, I'm moderate. That's another way of saying is, it's okay with me if a working woman on a low salary spending every last penny that she has to support her children is not covered for contraceptives under her employer health plan, and has to spend the money out of pocket, which she does not have to buy it. I'll never forget this. When I was a young man, I read a book by the great French writer Anatole France, who said that he lived in a country where the rich and poor alike were equally free to sleep under the bridge at night. I mean, come on. This is a legitimate issue. And this is supposed to be a libertarian state where you believe people should control their own bodies, their own lives, and not be overborne by the state. And that brings me to the last argument I want to make. Mark Udall is on the Intelligence Committee, and he led the fight in the United States Congress against overreaching by the National Security Agency in listening to your phone calls and reading your emails so that we could protect the national security but not interfere with the personal privacy of people. So, Mark Udall is what you say you want. His opponent is an attractive, articulate, good-natured fellow, impressive. But he was voted the 10th most conservative member of the House of Representatives. That means he is 9 steps away from the most right-wing extremist in the Congress that has shut down all progress and believes it is immoral, honestly believes it is wrong to work with Democrats. You've got to crush them, and we've now got a time where people are confused, so let's just load it on and confuse everybody. Mark Udall is what you say you want. You want Republicans and Democrats to work together? You want to solve real problems? You want a shared future with shared responsibilities and shared prosperity? You have to elect Mark Udall. You've got to send him back to the Senate. And look, I can say this because I can't run for anything anymore. When you're done with politics, and when you've reached a certain age so you know you've got more yesterdays than tomorrows, you think more about the tomorrows. And when it's over, there are only 3 things that matter. Are people better off when you quit than when you started? Do your children and grandchildren have a brighter future? And are we going to go into the future together or being torn apart? If you can give the right answer to those 3 questions, the rest is all background music. There are so many states in our beloved country that would give anything to have a governor like John Hickenlooper. Or and a senator like Mark Udall. They would. This is the easiest place in the country to vote. All you have to do is to recognize that every day you're going to pass lots and lots and lots of people who still haven't voted or don't know who they're going to vote for. The Republicans are voting like crazy early because they want to pop the president one more time. That'll be over in 2 years. Whether you support or oppose the president, he has to leave in 2 years. These guys are amazing. One of them wants you to give him a 4-year job for a 2-year protest, a job in Colorado that has nothing to do with Washington. The other one wants a 6-year job for a 2-year protest, and he basically announced by his whole record, being the 10th most far-right member of the House, that he'll punish you for 6 years, but he thinks you will feel pretty good on Election Day. Think. You are a state of the future. The only thing that makes sense is for us to think about the future and to build it together with John Hickenlooper and Mark Udall. Thank you, and God bless you. Thank you.